far as issues of being, what it is to work in the studio, what modernism is, abstraction, and other issues that Ian will go into as he goes along. I did send out some readings for you, so I hope some of you were able to read some of those, or finish your readings. And yes, we have lots up here for you to look at, and this issue of the old Vanguard that the David McElwain article is from. It used to be a Vancouver Art Gallery, the Vancouver Art Gallery.
Question of my intellectual biases, that I studied at UBC in the 60s, I studied art history. I got my degree, my master's degree in art history, and taught art history classes at the university from 1967 to 70, and then at the original Vancouver School of Art from 1972 right through to 1998, when I took early retirement from teaching. And I taught occasionally a studio course, usually in the interdisciplinary department, but I taught really basically art history and theory and critical theory, etc. So, you know, the painting as critique, and you might say the intellectual biases and the kind of subject matter that painting as a practice, as an artistic practice, can carry, is something that's always been a part of my double identity as an artist and as an art historian, even though I've done very little pure art historical publishing. Most of my publishing, which is considerable actually, I'm gathering together all of my writing for kind of to publish as a proper book. But in back in, this is an article from 1983, which is, you know, more than 30 years ago, on painting in spite of art. It's on the Artist Gallery of Williams, which is at Carr Park University. I've done numerous in the, you know, from the 60s on, publishing art criticism, I used to write art criticism in the Vancouver Sun and Province in the mid-60s, which is really why I got my job at UBC, is the D.C. Bain, who's the director of the art history or the art history program at UBC, who was my studio program, and liked my writing, and so he decided to hire me. I was quite young at the time. And on the, you know, subjects of painting, myself as a painter, because I get identified as a photographer and or painter. And as I see it in my practice, especially since the beginning of the 80s, has been an amalgamation of the two practices, or kind of a pas de deux, or kind of a dialectical relationship between these two sometimes conflictual modes of expression, but not always. I'm interested in conflictual aspects of it, and sometimes exaggerate that. But I bring them to work together. This is a catalog from an exhibition at Charles Scott Gallery from 2005 called In the Studio. So studio practice, even though, as I emphasize in my same intellectual biases, studio practice has always been fundamental kind of point of view, a fundamental kind of way of spending life. I'm in the studio of Ellison every day, just about every day. All my time is spent in the studio or traveling, doing shows, walking in the woods too. You know, I have a life as well. So I'm going to start with just a very quick survey, just a few minutes survey, just to get for those of you who are not familiar with the range of my work over the years and the various transitions and transformations I've gone through. It's a very capsule view of this right now, and I've done. Matter of fact, in my archive, my assistant said he had realized you got 3,000 entries in your archive before. I find this is over 50 years. Some of them are editions, which of course multiplies a single work out a number of times, but not huge editions. So I've done, this works I forgot what I've done. This is just to begin. The first serious work I take seriously as accounting for something, really begins in the spring of 1967. This is a work from 1968, and I decided in 1967 as sort of like to start with what I call the zero point. Start with the monochrome, which of course in the 60s and the mid-60s was the period of minimal art, was the kind of the avant-garde edge of the moment. And of course, a little bit later, the conceptual art was received. And I was like picking up on all of these latest movements of the time. I think, not in a naive way, because I was quite aware of how I interpreted it and how I could absorb it into my own practice in a legitimate way. But it's quite influenced by current trends, I have to say. And it took me for a while, and we all go through the experience of maturing and self-questioning, where you kind of begin to originate your own language. As you see in this one, it's just a chrome yellow heat, cadmium yellow heat, sorry. And I did a number of paintings from this period of 1967 through to 1968. This actually was my last one I did. And in the fall of 1968,
grab me into the wall and walk back across the room 30 feet.
in order to see the line going up. So I was kind of working in those kinds of modes, which at that time where it was not the usual way of presenting the concept of painting. Now there's like, we're used to kind of manning it. In 1970, oh, by the way, these three arched windows right here into the Hastings and Seymour, it's now the Drake Room Hall. Used to be my studio, that's my studio room right up there. And this is the corner of Hastings and Seymour in the summer of 1970, May 1970. I started to pick up on the idea of like photography as a means of kind of indexing or referencing things in the everyday world in the street that would actually also parallel my interest in the concept of the painterly image. And now from a documentary relationship to the photograph. I don't consider this a fine photograph in the classic sense of a really good photograph. It's a photograph that's just acknowledging and registering and indexing, in effect, the actuality of the everyday world that has these vectors that I see as relating directly to pictoriality. This is a whole other concept of mine about what I call the idea of the picture. Pictorial image in the rectangular formation is directly related to the architectural framing of concepts that think of the Parthenon as a classic example of an architectural framing in a classic Roman section, you might say, that is in itself a reflection of the whole fundament of Western rationalism. And this, the extension of that whole fundament of Western rationalism right into contemporary times is reflected in the grid structure of the modern city and the breaking down of lived space into alienated units that we call private property that's owned by individuals or corporations or whatever. And the modern city, of course, is the gathering of all of these elements into the grid structure, which is itself a reflection of the rectangularity of the pictorial model of Western rationalism and our whole high capitalist economy, so to speak. That was the part of the rationalizing of what I was doing here with walk signs, crossing of people in traffic. But the real model in these photographs that I was referring to is the rectangular model of painting and the white line again, which is in the rectangle of the painted crosswalk and intersection format you see in every modern city, especially in Vancouver. And I still, to this day, do works that refer back to this model. So this particular picture, which I call Intersection 1970, is, you might say, the first kickoff of a whole conceptual relationship to phenomena, politics, aesthetics, etc., that runs through my work ever since. It's not the end all of it, but it's a fundamental. Another work that I started doing in 1969, and this is one shown at the UBC Fine Arts Gallery in February 1971 in a show called Collage Show, put on by Chris Dipiakos at the UBC Fine Arts Gallery. I was living in London at the time, so I never did actually see this piece. It was put up by somebody else. It is called a magazine piece. And all it is the cover and facing pages of a mass circulation publication arranged on the wall in a given format and a given arrangement until the format's exhausted, is what the schema for it is. This was 17 magazine. I specified 17 because for like, $5 at the time, you had something like 100 pages of beautiful color photographs. So to do a painting on the wall, of course I was living in London, I didn't have money to do a painting and ship it to Vancouver or anything. So all it took was a letter and a diagram to send this to Vancouver. This is like classic conceptual art at the time. But I, on the theme of painting, that I consider this a painting, and I still do this. It's an unlimited edition. I sold 20 of them so far for $1,000 each over the past 45 years. So they don't, they're not exactly flying out the door. But and then if anybody that buys them for $1,000 has the right to install them in any format they want, any magazine they want at any time. So it's, you know, they're all over. In fact, one was recently shown in urban art projects. Lane and Kathleen Brown, who pulled out a collection from North Shore, installed one in the Griffin Art Projects in North Vancouver, which is a project space run by the Frygas, Perdita and Frygas. And they have an opening coming up in March 3rd. They just took the current show down. It's just ended the other day. Carrying on with this interest in media and photography, in the early 70s, I got myself a little bit more stabilized. I quit the job at UBC and moved to London for a year trying to become a conceptual artist in London, and that didn't go very far. I came back to Vancouver and floundered for a year, and then got a job teaching art history again at the original Vancouver School of Art, which gave me some stability and a little bit of money for materials to get back to work again. Jeff Wall came back to Vancouver from London also in 1973, and Rodney Graham, who was a student of mine at UBC in the late 60s when I was teaching art history there, we got together and said we're going to make a film. We did a number of attempts at it, I think we all agree they were complete failures because nothing ever came of it. But I was determined, after all the time and money we spent trying to do this film, I was going to get something out of it. So I did a piece called Summer Script, which consists of 12 4-foot by 6-foot photographs of the filming process of trying to make this film, which was about marriage. All of our marriages were breaking down at the time, so it was a topic. The slide on the left are stills from a video sketch of the dramatic substance of the film, with the individuals in the film in the scene talking, just from one scene from the film. The second one is photographs of an attempt to redo the film a second time, using stills that are in the script book, as you see on the table. It's called the Summer Script. And here's a detail of it. Yeah, this is the detail of it. And on this point here, you can see the script book with the dialogue that's kind of packed in the book. And one of the photographs that's in the other set of photographs taken from the video. So the whole thing is like using a photography as a cinematic model. The photographs you see them in color here, but they're actually hand painted. So technically they're using photographs, but also they're also painted because you get a little bit of cotton batting and oil paint, and you just kind of rub it in gently. And it's just a way of hand coloring black and white photographs. At this time, you really couldn't do color photographs this large. I bought from Guildford in Switzerland, a 100-foot roll of 49-inch black and white photographic paper. And actually, I used my lecture room at the art school as my studio and brought the projectors out, and there was a drainage thing in the basement, so there was a drainage thing on the floor, so I was able to drain the chemicals out of the, and then made these huge chemical trays and chemicals and like that. So these are pretty rough, you can see in the photograph. Because they dry them overnight before I had my class the next day. I hung them over the pipes. They were the kind of heating pipes. So I hung them over the pipes. And of course, it cost some crimping on the paper. This is currently in the collection of the Art Gallery of Winnipeg. There's a missing image here. It's supposed to be of image text. From 1979. That one was 1973. The Summer Script was 1973. This is just a still of me working at my table from a piece called Image Text from 1979. I was really into this at this point of kind of questioning like my artistic identity through photography and kind of reflecting on the actual process of making a work in the process of doing it. This is actually a work, it's called Citation. And it was a catalog from an exhibition in Vienna I did a few years ago, in which it just, I wrote an essay here, as you can see, on image text and commentary of the work. I went through a few pages. And I like the layout so much I just laid it out on the table and photographed it. It's now an inkjet print and an additional pen. I tend to do these inkjet prints that are done as additions that kind of refer to my work, recite to my work. The next stage in the next stage in the work is after 19. There's another one missing from my slide list. I don't know what happened to it. Oh, it's okay. I did a piece called Poverty in 1980, which was again, I was running short of money and wanted to make work. It was kind of like, so I had a old 16 millimeter movie camera. And I had a 100 foot roll of black and white film. I got some friends to kind of dress up in old clothes and pretend that they were transients. And we went down the old great railway yards. And I did this film called Poverty. Just it was kind of like a bohemian fantasy of homelessness. It wasn't real homelessness. I didn't want to go around to vacant lots and photograph really disadvantaged homeless people, you know. So I made my own script of it, in effect. I made a short film, on a 100-foot roll of film, of the 8 different scenes. From each of these scenes, I took one still and made the work called Poverty. That was my, and what I ended up doing by 1982 is putting those images on the canvas. I was trying to find a way to ground those images in a means other than to photograph. So I did them the poverty piece, the classic poverty piece, this silk screen on canvas with bright colors. Unfortunately, I can't show them to you. By 1985, Expo 86 was happening in 1986. In 1985, a Colorific Photo Labs got in a big machine to do large-scale photography laminated onto aluminum or foam or, you know, various kinds of grounds to do for the publicity for the Expo 86. And this machine was quite expensive, so they did a major investment in it because they got all this work coming in to do it for the first time. This really spectacular image. Also, color photography and black and white photography was available commercially in large scale, just actually a little bit after this. So I put the two together and realized, well, I can get blown up photographs and laminate. If you can laminate on aluminum, you can laminate on canvas. So I got the Colorific people to do the first laminations on canvas and tests and such, using them already, actually. And then I conceived of this work called My Heroes in the Streets in 1986. These are some of the first ones I ever did. My Heroes in the Streets, in which I just got friends of mine, some of them artists, some of them not artists, just to walk around the streets with me and I'd photograph them in the street. So they would be like my Baudelairean hero in the street, hero of modern life at intersections, etc., etc. It's a way of photographing a city and a figure at the same time. And I'm going to bring it into this discussion in a bit, this question of figure and ground. That's a fundamental question about painting. In painting, you have the blank canvas, and first you want to make a mark on it. Even the simplest mark, like a slash even of the canvas by Lucio Fontana, for instance, is a kind of form of figure against the ground. The canvas becomes the field. Just like there's the field of reality, we stand as individuals in the field of reality, trying to make sense of it. I see painting as a fundamental, the philosophical sense of painting, as a fundamental attempt to make a sense of what that figure is going to be in the field or the ground of reality. But of course, in painting is an emblem of that, and therefore you're on the rectangular pictorial frame or of the quadrant of the frame of the image. Then laminated, these are photographs, 30 by 40 inch photographs onto 90 by 120 inch canvases. Is that right? Is that, no, 90 by 40 pops, sorry, each canvas. 90 inches, 3 times 30, 90 by 45. And so they're just inside the center, and the three of them. This is Keith Grove, who was my super in the apartment building I was living in at the time. Rodney Graham, Ed here. Shayla Keeley is part of Toronto. Of these three, I did quite a few of these. We're just looking at a small example. Here's the proposal on Keith. You can see it's at Burrard and Georgia Street. Vancouver. I was in front of the Vancouver Tower right here in 1986. It's funny that I look at these things and it just like takes me right back there to that moment. They're so kind of like personal memories, I suppose.
Keith was a student here.
He was a student at Simon Fraser, that's right too, with Ken Long and Jeff Wall's class. And then I taught that class for a semester. In about that time, actually quite back, 1984-85, it was at across the Woodward's building on Hastings Street. That's where we started our band in the late 70s, U-Jerks. We used to have all our instruments there and play music in the space after hours. Here's another later example of heroes in the streets. Large ones. These are 11 feet wide by 6 feet high, and has Arne Bergson on the escalator in the Pacific Center. Roy Arden coming out of an office building lobby. Wendy Elliott right across from the old Bush House, the apartment building I used to live in at Carroll and Thurl Street. Rodney lived there as well. Keith Grove was the super in that building. Wendy lived downstairs. These are all kind of local sites. This piece is now in the collection of the Art Gallery of Ontario. I kind of like this idea that like personal, quite local situations end up in museum collections that are seen by people like hopefully 100 years from now, and they can intersect with something that happened, well, for years, like more than 30 years ago, before most of them were born. So I kind of like this collapse of history from the past to the present that's registered in the figuration, in the figure of photography set against the what I call the ideal field of painting, the canvas. Here's some more later ones. This is 88, 89. And these ones, they're photographs that were laminated, they're diptychs, photographs laminated onto 4x8 stretchers, or 4x8 canvases. On one side would be the photograph, and the other panel is a monochrome of a 4x8 sheet of plywood. So the works here are totally based upon the standard format size of construction material of plywood. And what I would do is just paint a big sheet of canvas, and then ink a sheet of plywood, degrade the worst plywood possible, because it's got lots of nice knot holes and marks. Here. You ink it with printer's ink, slow drying, and then you lay it down on the canvas and do a monoprint by stomping on the black of the canvas, and it picks up, of course, the textures and the ink plywood from the front. And by doing this, this gets back to this question of gesture, of translating, instead of doing the typical gestural mark, an expressive painterly mark, it's done in this case with the feet on the floor or on the back of the canvas and then lifted off. So you have that kind of nice gritty kind of texture that comes off of it that kind of speaks about the materiality of the painting in relationship to the photograph. This is Wendy DeBreyer, Lise Lemieux, who's an artist in my studio, LC Mills as well. Jordan Sisko, and Elizabeth Ballaston, running across the street. I saw her across the street and I called her, "Hi Elizabeth," she kept running over and caught her in a photograph running across the street. There's the closer up of the one of Lisa Mute, right at the end of the Hampton Street Bridge. We had just moved into our studio at 188 West 3rd at that time. Oh no, this is a little bit later, this is 88, so we've been there a couple of years. We've been there almost 30 years now. I did a show in Saint-Étienne in France in 89. On one side, I had three men with Robert Klein down here, Douglas Street, Tom Burrows in Toronto, and David Dalton. And on the other side, I had three women, Elizabeth Ellison again, Wendy DeBriner, and Dorothy Trujillo. These works are in the collection museum of modern art that's in Canada, France. So again, I really like this idea of very immediate, personal, local situations being injected into a totally other world. So what's so amazing about that, but it's kind of neat. Here's another one. Piece again with the plywood, but this is a diptych piece on the front of construction sites, very neat form here behind the car and cars in the bottom. I've done so many of them. These are just ones that appeal to me when I look at the. Okay, that's a quick summary only of a fraction of the actual work and theme that I've been doing. There's three fundamental themes that run through my work, and they're based upon locations. One is the studio, or once I showed you the ones at the street, of the studio and the museum. So we'll see some examples of all these, and I'm coming to the studio ones to really talk about the idea about artistic practice and painting and such. But I wanted to kind of divert now onto another sidetrack that I've already touched upon, and that's this idea of figure and field. Part of this, my inspiration, this concept of figure and field, comes from seeing the work of Barnett Newman. That could be in a number of arts. There was Barnett Newman's work that was kind of puzzling, and I had to really come to terms with it, that brought it up in a more kind of direct way. I first saw his work in 1962 at the Seattle World's Fair. And I was just out of high school at the time. And of course, I didn't really understand it then, but it never left me. I never forgot it. This is a piece called Cathedral. It's in the Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam. There's two lines, one white line on a big blue field, it's more than 20 feet long, grand history scale painting, and a line just made from tape. He did his first blue underground, put a tape over it, then painted more blues to make it richer, painted it more impassive white, and then took the tape away to reveal the underground with the first coat of blue. So there's a physical malerisch, they call it in German painterliness in this, even though it doesn't look that way. It's not classic Art Deco painting, but related to it, obviously. There's this very funny photograph taken when it was first exhibited in New York in 1951 by Barnett Newman on the side, and I don't think that's Betty Parsons, but it was in the Betty Parsons Gallery. Just to me, it's kind of emblematic of this image of figure and field, but also another theme that runs through my work is of masculine and feminine. This kind of like creation of emblematic images of opposition. And it was my kind of rather clumsy attempt or something, but kind of referring indirectly to a kind of gender qualities. This is another painting by Barnett Newman, which is one of my very favorites, called Vera Rose, and this is the world of sublime life. Very large painting in the Museum of Modern Art. And right next to it, usually hung together, but not always, is another one. It's called The Wild. And it's only, it's 8 feet bar. It's only a little over 2 inches wide. And it's got a red, with a blue ground and a red stripe down the middle. I'm certain, and I'm working on a thesis on this, and I'm kind of, finding the proof from it, in my notes or something, that he just took one of his bars that he made his canvas on. Exactly the same size. It took some extra candlesticks and unveiled probably the world's narrowest, tallest painting. In Vancouver, we have the world's narrowest building just down on Penn Street to the Penn Valley. And here's a pretty funny picture of Barnett Newman, a pretty goofy looking guy, on the left, with Betty Parsons on the right, with the Wild right in between. I like these kinds of photographs because they kind of resonate with my interest in dialectics, gender dialogue between masculine male and female, but also the somewhat of the absurdity too of this minimal mark. This is really the Martin Luther's version of the minimal condition of painting. And this is a photograph I took in my studio this day before yesterday. I'm working on it, you know, as over all these years, on my crosswalks intersection series, which I showed you that intersection 1970 with the interview lines. This is taken in New York City, and it's just a couple of young men and a woman standing together waiting to cross the street. I photographed them from behind, and I cut the photograph in half and split it onto two different canvases so that there's a kind of a, there's each one of them forms a kind of a figure against the field, and then it's joined together in this diptych structure, which is, runs through all my work. And you see on the table in front here, the study for it. I'm going to do a blue. I have painted it that would be blue in it. You see it in the study. Am I going too fast? No. Next, I want to kind of touch upon this a problematic that exists in questionable painting, and that's, you know, where does painting fit into the expression of modern life, modern meaning, so to speak? Starting in the mid-60s, there was a major kind of reaction against painting, mostly brought up by conceptual artists, and the originator, I suppose, of all this, Duchamp, and the followers and writers that followed Duchamp's questioning of the legitimacy of painting and, as a legitimate hierarchical medium of high art expression in the 20th century. The conceptual artists started critiquing painting, you know, painting as critique, and critiquing painting as being too embodied in the existing model of high bourgeois culture, and that contemporary artists, radical contemporary artists, had to find other means of breaking out of that. And I bought into that. I mean, it makes sense in certain levels. At the same time, so I say my relationship with painting has been a struggle of reconciling kind of various kinds of seemingly legitimate directions that one can take as an artist without pulling yourself apart, like quartering yourself to be offended. How do you kind of bring it back together? And all my work has been an attempt to resuture, in effect, the antagonistic conflicts that have existed in high culture, high pictorial culture, visual arts culture, between conceptual models or intellectual models and expressive models. And this is one of the photostat pieces by Joseph Kosuth. He did a number of them, and this is one this, where he took a dictionary definition of painting and did it as exhibited as a photostat. I don't have an installation shop, but they were exhibited like paintings on the wall. In fact, they were wall work in that classic sense. And of course, Kosuth then sells them, shows with Castelli Gallery, so he's as much part of the painting market as any painter can be, except that all of his work is kind of about a reaction against painting as at least the materiality of to form the ground for me. Another one was John Baldessari from Los Angeles artist here. Everything's emerged from this painting, but art, right, no idea has been in this work. And it's actually a painting. It's hand-painted lettering on canvas. This was earlier this year. Ankawara, this repetitive date painting, Ankawara, I mean, they're beautiful. I don't mean, I'm not running down. Where every day he would paint the date of that day, and that was his painting for the day. These paintings are quite small, only about 20 by 24 inches, and for each day, he bought a newspaper, got a cardboard box, and took a page from the newspaper that day, and then the painting was in the box, and then they're stacked up, and then exhibited and sold.
Those are hand lettered.
Yeah, hand lettered, yeah. Very, very precise. Of course, Ron Terada is a local painter whose works kind of reflect very, very closely the modus operandi of Ankawara. Now, when I was teaching at what's now in New Carr University, went through like several name changes, used to be the Vancouver School of Art, the painting faculty were a little bit antagonistic to my art history teaching because I was dragging the students away. Is that right? Yes, you were there. dragging the students somewhat away from a certain kind of ideal of expressive painting and taking conceptual art seriously. In fact, I brought people like Lawrence Winger, Joseph Kasuth, Michael Asher, etc., brought in as visitors to the art school through my contemporary art program. And these were people who were kind of like very kind of programmatically working contra painting. So I understand some of the trepidations of the painters in the Emily Park faculty, but they're kind of a little bit of an attitude. Fanon was, of course, exhibiting work and getting quite good shows and quite productive, actually. I sent us their attitude. I respected them all as artists. I had no problems. In fact, some of them I had more respect. I wish I'd paid more attention to what they were doing at the time than I did when I review what they had done. Anyway, so it's a part of a joke, but they kind of felt that, oh, Ian Wallace, he's the art historian. Why is this happening in our territory? You know, like, why is he making things difficult for us? So it's kind of a joke. I did this show at the Orr Gallery when it was on Franklin Street in April 1983, in which, and of course I was teaching, so the show I couldn't be there, but it was kind of a performance that involved me just sitting and reading in the exhibition space. And all I did, was allowed to come in the gallery space. They could only see me from the window from the street. And all I did was read in a little window. Or gallery, by the way, was started by Lai Wan Chung. You might know Lai Wan. She was teaching it for
some
years. Yeah, in Simon Fraser. And this used to be a restaurant called Food for Thought. And she was living in the back. And she says, Ian, I can't pay the rent. What am I going to do? I said, well, why don't you have a nice front room there. Why don't you turn it into a little gallery? And artists can show there and pay that part of the rent for the month and help out. So that's where the art gallery got started. She painted out the words Food for Thought and left just Orr left over. That's where they named the word gallery from. Anyways, I did this show there. The curtains were pulled aside only from midnight to 1 o'clock in the morning, as it says on my poster, midnight to 1 a.m., so people could come and see. So everybody would go to the bar, and then after the bar, they come driving by, and there'd be a whole line of people, mostly friends, kind of like, why a piece of beer, etc. But they had to wait till 1 o'clock, and then they'd come in and a bit of partying and such. But the irony is that I was doing all this work at the time. You see a big drawing in the back of it. I had a projector, there it is right there, projector, and projecting images to myself and drawing to myself on photographs and a light box. And, in fact, I did an edition of 3 of all of these things, and they're all in collections, including the National Gallery, etc., etc. So, ironically, in a while I'm posing, it's just somebody who's just sitting there reading, doing nothing, just being in the collection. Actually, the book I was reading was Soren Kierkegaard's Concept of Irony, so the whole thing is built about irony. And Kierkegaard's book on irony is about Socrates. And Socrates is the great philosopher that never wrote a word. All of Socrates' philosophy was written down by his students, Plato and Aristotle. So, you know, the whole thing's about irony, about what it is to really produce and produce ideas, and produce thought, etc., etc. In 1984, I took sabbatical from teaching and moved to Rome, and I didn't have 20, and I knew that once I got to Rome and I had some shows coming up and I needed some work, so I better get something together pretty fast. So I took one of the studio spaces at Emily Carr, the old Vancouver School of Art, and just before I left, and mocked up an image as though I had a studio. In fact, it was called In the Studio, 1984. In fact, I didn't have a studio at the time, and I got those 4 faces, me sitting, you know, with writer's block up with the typewriter, me looking at photographs of an image of poverty on the wall and behind, and just down below. Of course, poverty was done just before that, and I was working on a poverty series at this time. Here Jane's staring at a blank monochrome, and here you read, you know, all the kind of the things that I tend to do. Mostly lying on the couch. And then I did all kinds of side works and drawing from this. These are just tracings on the vellum, which I did off the photographs. and then did additions for the tracing. So I was able to generate from four little photographs quite a lot of work. I did a series of lithographs, and then in 2008, I needed to very quickly Captain Jeffrey's gallery to show that. Actually, I'm just giving you hints on how to get things done. She had a booth at Basel, and the art fair in Basel, Switzerland. I said, Ian, I need a big major piece for this, and I need it really fast. I don't know. It takes me about 6 weeks minimum to turn around to get a work like this done. And so, what I'm going to do, and that was, I realized it was exactly 25 years to the month, April 2008. And April 1983 would be 25 years, so I said, I should do a redo of that work. The piece was done in the Art Gallery. But what was I going to do? And I realized that Catrona's gallery was empty at the time, because they were just between shows. They just took a show down and waited until the next one up. So I phoned Catrona and said, Catrona, can I have your gallery for the afternoon? Yes, we can. So I quickly
got a friend with a truck, and we got stuck together and photographed. At the table, I brought my book, I even brought the concept of irony with me, and did this piece called At Work 2008. You see, there were four diptychs, actually, and a video. I did a presentation of the video of me sitting going through these four phases of my practice. There's me at the typewriter, which is now my computer. Looking at photograph and looking at monochrome. That made the cover of the catalog that was done in 2008 as well. How are we doing for time? It's 2 o'clock. Okay, can I go through really fast now? Pictures of my studio, woodblock. Photographs of canvas on the table. This is some of my favorite stuff, actually. A, is conceptually, it's so easy to do. But I think it would be beautiful, you know, just like a photograph with the afternoon light going on the work table, on the sensuality of the actual canvas texture with my tools and everything there. That's what painters love. They just love that, you know, the smell of paint and the handling of the material. Now, the other thing I like about these works is the high-resolution photography. You can see the texture of the canvas, but the texture of the canvas is actually laminated on the canvas background, so that the actual physical texture of the real canvas comes through and just matches the illusionistic texture of canvas in the foreground itself. So you have this really odd kind of frisson of texture that happens. Here's another piece called Support Surface, which is the name of a French group of abstract artists that are dealing with some of the same problems. It's in the Toronto collection. It's now in the Toronto Foundation in Milan in an exhibition there. I'm going there in a week or 2 weeks to go and see it and photograph. This is another kind of a couple of joke paintings I can't resist to show you. This is my two assistants, Kitty Merman and Wendy Elliott, painting a monochrome background for a piece I did in a solidarity show in Poland in 1990, which on the side of the like a string of photographs from a Polish film that would go down the side here. We are painting it. This is a painting I keep in my studio, just as a little emblematic memento of what real art is actually doing. This is another, I was looking out my studio window 2 years ago, and Post Mountain Co-op, right on the side up here, down the back of my studio window. I'm on the second floor, so looking down. So I look up, and there's these guys painting the parking lot lines. They're perfect. That's, you know, they're painters, they're real painters, and they're painting lines, like my favorite subject. So this is a diptych called Painting Lines. These guys don't know that they're. Now they're real artists, they're consecrated in art history. You don't realize that. One day they'll be in the school. We don't really have time. An artist I very much admire, Montreal artist. famous for his striped hard edge paintings. And we don't see much work from Montreal anymore, do we? No, it's really a shame. Canada's really falling apart and becoming subdivision. But Molinari had a big presence in Vancouver. I had a chance to visit Molinari's studio, this is after he died, and snooping around, I went into, you know, to really find out what goes on behind the canvas, you got to go into the room, the cleanup room, right? So we had a cleanup room behind the exhibition space where they had all of this French paintings and whatever. And amazingly, they spit out all of this stuff, his paints, his like his brushes, his old paint cans, and stuff is on the wall, so I photographed it. I said, this is it, this is the Vanadas of contemporary artists, right? Contemporary abstract painter. So I photographed it, and you know, masking tape on the wall, and I realized that this, what I found interesting in here is this artist famous for his hard edge paintings, unconsciously was an expressionist, a gesturalist, an expressionist, because this wall, he's cleaned off his paintworks. He didn't use a brush, he used rollers. So he's cleaning off his paintworks here on, in his cleanup space. And actually, these become his paintings. So I did this. It was purchased recently by the Montreal Museum of Fine Arts, who did the first show of Molinari and who has a big Molinari collection. And so it perfectly placed here my kind of vanitas about Molinari and gesturalism. You know, place back to the birthplace of Molinari's work. Ironically, well, not so ironically, is that Molinari's early work in the early 50s, before he was a hard edge painter, he did his blindfold paintings. In other words, he blindfolded himself and did all these gestural paintings without actually seeing what he was painting. And here's one, and here's another one. And if you want to see some originals, if you go to the Rosewood Bar at the Georgia Hotel, if you go to the bar in the mezzanine in the lobby area, there's two of them hanging on the wall. They should be in the Vancouver Art Gallery, they should be in the museum, but they're just hanging on the wall, but they're totally valuable and rare works, and you never see those, even in museums. But I mean, some collector has them in part of the hotel, ownership or something, I don't know. They're hanging there, nobody knows what they are, except for me. And now you. Here's Molinari's Hobbes of Orange and Human. But I couldn't resist also, like, let's look at some gesture here. You know, like, we're only looking at art and painting and my kind of highly intellectual framing and painting and figure and field, etc. Here's one of my very favorite gestural painters, Joan Mitchell. Very, she's fantastic. She died just recently, actually. She was married to Jean-Paul Riopel, the Montreal artist who was saying he's one of the compatriots of Buda Molinari. They lived in Paris. So they were, she's American, but they were Parisian since the late 40s. And these are her works. And one of my favorite of her works is called Ladybug. Here it is here. You know, quite large paintings, this total gestural messes, but absolutely beautiful. And she's a major inspiration for Gordon Smith's painting as well. And here's a work of mine, one of my museum series. It's called In the Museum of Art and Women. It's the edge of the mural of Columbus. And all I do is photograph the space between the label and the work, and then incorporate it into a composition. I did my master's thesis in art history on Keith Mondrian. Of course, all of his work is about abstract painting as a form of composition. Oh, highly rationalistic work. I think it's highly beautiful. But, and here's another one of my museum series in the museum with Keith Mondrian. And here's a large series I did. They're 8 feet high by 6 feet wide. No, 5 feet wide, sorry. And it's photographs of the same stretchers and canvases that is, see, the original canvas was stretched, put on the wall, photographed, and laminated onto the same canvas and stretcher, so it's totally self-reflexive. What you see is what the physicality of it is. This is a photograph of
photograph of canvas that's then laminated on the canvas, so you have that canvas texture coming through and doubling on the illusion of the texture of the canvas. These are kind of monochrome sections that are silk screen of canvas texture on top of. So the whole thing is kind of like a symphony, I think of it, because of the scale anyways, about painting as materiality, about what a painting is as a physical fact. And then this series of five, there are currently in New York, 1,000 works in New York. And of course, I can wrap up in kind of 3 more minutes. Thanks for your question. This is here we see an early blank piece and a white line. I still will show these pieces. This is an installation of a piece called the Abstract Paintings, the Financial District, shown at the power plant in Toronto. I show this to you now because this whole series of 12 8-foot by 6-foot photographs of the panorama of the Financial District of Toronto, all the corporate architecture, as you see, is now in the collection of the National Gallery of Ottawa and currently installed there. I'm going at the end of February to do a VIP dinner and talk about the work. So it's just kind of a nice way to wrap up this little talk. And here's some details. This one right here is one of my favorites. It's just a businessman that was in the lobby of one of these buildings, and he was wandering around, pacing around alone, doing some kind of urgent emergency panic telephone call on the phone. And here's an image of a series of what I produce as inkjet prints called Works in Progress. And for every major series I do, I photograph the actual production process and the scene of production in my studio. And then I produce them as inkjet editions. And usually I get the edition to the gallery, it shows the work, and then they get to sell it, sometimes to raise money for the gallery itself, for the exhibition, or whatever. My drum set, I like to do jam sessions in my studio after hours once a week. And here's this picture you just looked at. And there's the form of paint. That's it. I think that's probably enough. Thank you very much for your attention. Happy to answer any questions.
Articulated in very precise compositional detail.
And you know, composition is another way of speaking of objects, as I see it, arranging objects. And part of the pleasure of looking at any picture is, you know, of a work that's not your own, is kind of looking at how it's all put together, how things suture to each other and form a unified and harmonious composition. Pleasing or unpleasing, sometimes you have to jolt things a little bit so it throws them off. It's totally Mondrian, yeah. My thesis was the evolution of this abstract painting, the evolution of neoclassicism, 1910 to 1920. And I studied in detail every single work he did and trying to understand every decision he made going from one work to another as to how he made that process. I wrote it between 66 and 68. So that's the same time when I was dealing with my own attempt to formulate my original approach to what I thought was serious painting. Good question. Thank you. All right.
Thank you. I'm curious about, or I was interested in the way you kind of framed modern city and the grid as embodying sort of like a supernatural thought. And then later when you're photographing kind of city scenes, and you're just having this individual that, given that like you're working with a lot of irons,
yeah.
I'm curious whether this individual sort of sometimes looking at the box maybe or alienated by the city, it's kind of embodies a binary of against rationality, or where that the individual perceives the individual in that scene.
I do pose people at intersections, like my At the Crosswalk series, like on the poster, for instance. That piece, those people are posed. They're actually hired and paid and posed. The man in that picture is an investment banker who works quite close by to the Vancouver Art Gallery, and they had this huge banner in front of the art gallery, and his friends were looking at, is that him? What's he doing? So, there is specific people, but often there are people I don't know and could never possibly stop everybody in the street and say, pardon me, do you mind if I photograph you in the image? But I just see people, even if I don't know them, they stand for individuals. Actually, the heroes of the streets never started. I was in New York, crossing Fifth Avenue, and there was a guy walking next to me. Geez, he looks familiar. Who's that? It was Woody Allen. And I figured, this is we're all heroes in the street, we're all individuals, we all live in these cities, not all of us, all, but we're urbanites, I am anyways. And these are people that experience what it is to live in the world. So as I see it, and everybody has collapsed their own heroic individuality, but also all of the compression of all the pressures of modern urban society in our economy. That one of the financial district series, the businessmen in the lobby and people in the street are kind of reflecting on that too. It's a very indirect way of referring to kind of a political subject. And political ultimately does mean the polis, the people. What the people are about. And in those pictures, I'm trying to look up. Again, it's another struggle between what is it to be distant from your subject and also be a part of it, without being egotistical and swarming all of the subjects of the picture with your personality, of leaving a room of space in it to talk about things that have nothing to do with me personally, right? And have to do with things that everybody experiences as well. So I'm trying to kind of pull those compositions together.
Well, I was thinking of the fact exactly what Dave was thinking about, and I was thinking that in the way the figures in your works are people, they're like interlopers into an otherwise very structured urban environment, and in the way they stand in for you or for the artist,
yeah.
And they're the unpredictable element, you
that, of course, was fundamental to Pete Mondrian's kind of cornball thesis about verticality and horizontality as well. But there's, you know, the horizontal perspectives of the street are also met by the verticality of high-rise architecture, of skyscrapers and such as a part of the modern. And I tend to pick the city centers, you know, as the site of the work, because that's where the sublime space of these pressures of high capitalist economy exists in relationship to the natural will and desires and pressures that's on the individual that exists in the street.
It's a lifelong performance.
Yeah, it is. You know, it is.
We all perform. We all, and it's like, that's the exciting thing about Vancouver. It's like, there's people out there, there's six openings now, right? Like, people like getting their work out there and sharing it with everyone. We're all out there, right? And the other thing that you kind of brought up is that, you know, I learn from my students. Well, I don't think of them as, I think of it's like we're all working together on this, right? And it's all a feedback situation, give or take. You've always stood out to me.
Sure.
You might build your work up for only one on the ground.
Exactly. By the way, you should have talked me a few things about, you know, how to make other things on the side.
Talking about, you know, the same
shutting down or suppressing something in your personality on one level, you'll come in another level. And then an expressive artwork, it'll come in another way, sometimes more interesting from my point of view, I think. I'm a Virgo, so I'm only, in a way, just being who I am, what, you know, and I make my choices the way I do it. And I'm a pretty good drawer, actually. But when I try to loosen up to be really like Joan Mitchell, I don't think my marks are that interesting. I think my marks are more interesting when they're kind of rigorously controlled. But I have that thing between control and mind control. Virgos, I don't know. Virgos are people that are line things up, look at them, and then put them slowly like this. That's what Virgo is. You make things in order and all kind of like, and then you've got to throw a loop at other people. Because you don't want to admit that you're obsessed with the word. Or something.
I said you just did it.
That's right.
Well, thank you very much. Boy, you've got another question? It's always a pleasure to run into a friendly face with somebody you know in the street, especially by accident. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Did you live in Bush once?
For a while.
Well, that's it.
Hey.